Hi, my name is Sam Curry. I'm the Chief Security Officer for Cybereason and a visiting fellow for the National Security Institute. And today we're going to run through a short presentation, which I'll share here, about future-proofing security and how to be vigilant in doing so. So future-proof vigilance, the recipe for security from now on. In other words, how should we be approaching security to be able to handle all the challenges that are likely to come our way in the near or even distant future. So I thought I would start with some first principles. I'm as somebody whose initial training was in physics, I'm a big believer in first principles, the things from which we can derive everything else. And the first thing I'm gonna say is that there is an asymmetry in cyber conflict, that it's not the same fight on offense as on defense, that the attackers have a different kit, a different cadence, a different journey than the defenders. Unfortunately, right now, the attackers expect to win. And what I mean by that is, more often than not, they are successful in breaking environments. And personally, I get kind of upset when I hear that those that have been hacked and those that don't know it. I don't like the defeatist attitude. And as a CISO, I certainly don't come to work every day to lose. And so my personal mission, actually my company mission, is to try to change that, to reverse that. So the defenders expect to win in defense rather than the attackers enjoying the benefits of asymmetry. But the reason's quite simple. They are generally motivated and better equipped to break in. That they, for all that we don't want to lose, we don't typically in defense, in our security departments, have the same rate of improvement that the bad guys have in their offensive kit. So if we looked at this in calculus terms, the first derivative of proficiency is faster for the bad guys than for the good. We have to find ways to change this. And so I mention this up front because I want you to be thinking, right now the attackers are having a field day. They get to pick and choose time and the battlefield and the tools that are used. And we've got to be good everywhere. So what we've got to do is find some ways to jump enormously in our technology. That's the heart of being future-proof. And as the guardians, as the defenders, it's our job to try and find that. Now, most of modern security, after you get past controls, is based on something called Locard's principle. Locard was a 19th century French criminologist. You should feel free to Google that and look it up. And he believed and stated a simple principle that every time a crime was committed, there was an exchange of evidence between the criminal and the crime scene. And that's the basis for all those criminal TV shows that we see, the CSIs, where you go hunting for the fingerprint or the dirt sample or the blood sample in a crime scene. And we kind of do that too in security. What we do is we say, get all of the security relevant things, put them into a giant data structure and sort it out afterwards. Unfortunately, this has some very big problems, especially noise to signal ratio, finding the signal and having it in such a way that it is actionable, that you don't just find the signal, that you can trace it back and understand the human behavior behind the scene. And I'm gonna share something from a book called Sapiens by Yuval Harari. It's a phenomenal book, by the way, and a great story of us as a species. There's two types of chaotic system. The first is where you may have a lot of complexity and adaptation, but it's not intelligent. So an example of this would be hurricanes or storms in the meteorological system. The second is viruses in the biological system. I just picked two, and he actually discusses this more at length. But that's not what we're dealing with in cyber. Sure, that's what IT usually deals with. Nature is the enemy, failed parts, failed processes, those sorts of things. But in IT security, what we're dealing with is second order chaos, where the adaptation is intelligent and thoughtful. Humans are the enemy. All monsters in the end are human. Even our pursuit of AI is trying to create an artificial human and still seems to be wrapped around Turing's challenge. But at the moment, AIs are not the thoughts behind it. They are in service to humans. The enemy is still fundamentally human. And that is the most dangerous and adaptive creature that we know of. Humans didn't come to dominate this planet for better or worse by virtue of being the fastest or having the most natural weapons or the most aggression. It is because of how we are coordinated and intelligent and adaptive. The equivalent in the biological system would be, for instance, if COVID-19 was aware that it was going through an airport or being scanned for body temperature and lowered its host's temperature. It doesn't do that because it's not an intelligently adaptive threat. It's very adaptive, but we can beat that with a standard set of technologies. In business, there are only three places where you have intelligent adaptive opponents that I know of. The first is competition. They are intelligent. The second is legal conflict. The lawyers going after each other are intelligent in their strategies and tool choices. And IT security. In fact, these three disciplines have more in common with each other very often than they do with respect to IT. So security isn't, I've listed these three things, it isn't a control or a tech stack. It's not a framework and it's not a person, although all of those are definitely involved. So let's take a look at vigilance and what I think the real goals of security are. The purpose of security is acceptable risk for acceptable return. What do I mean by that? Well, I can tell you how to get zero risk, as it says on the slide here. You won't like that though. The reason you won't like that is the only way to do that is to in fact turn everything off. So if you don't want risk, don't go to business. Business exists to take acceptable risks, which means not take the unacceptable risks or put controls in place to prevent them. So that brings up the other key word here, business. We exist to service the business, not to stop it. We're not the department of no. We are not the department that is meant to inhibit business. I sometimes use the analogy of a car with brakes. There are brakes on a car to go very fast, not to stop the car, but to enable you to have the confidence to go at high speed. So the biggest problem I know of in security is a lack of alignment between the security department and the main business. We are seen often as the department of no or Dr. No. We are seen as the ones that you don't want to be invited or you bring in late or you get a pass from. But what we should be doing is in fact getting much more involved and aligning to the business. Our goal is to make the business faster and more flexible and to lower the risk from that human opponent, from the ghost in the machine, as I once called it. It's like exercise. I would very much like there to be a simple pill that you take and you're healthy, but the way to be healthy is to eat properly, get good sleep hygiene, and exercise regularly. And that's miserable, but that's the way to do it. In the same way, security doesn't have a one-year rack-mountable solution. You just plug it in, tighten it, and fill out your compliance checklist. That stuff is important, but that's not security. I'm going to put this forward as my statement of what security is and what we're supposed to be doing. It is what we do and how we do it. In other words, it's how you wake up and think about problems. It's about how you actually do the security job as opposed to the thing you install or use or configure or monitor. And I think that's really important. So putting that up front helps us to understand how we're going to get to that future-proof vision. Because it's not about whether you've got the latest tool. It's not about, you know, whether you've got the latest certification or the latest skill. It is, in fact, about how every day you stand back up and tackle the security problem. And that's how we get ahead in this. That's how we get future-proof. So continuous monitoring is really, because I know this is a big theme right now, about not letting any more go to the, it's not about not letting anything happen here, but stopping stuff more to the left and more reliably and in a more actionable way. So what is continuous monitoring? Because this term pops up again and again, and it has for over a decade. I'd like to propose that we think about it differently because human beings don't actually continuously monitor anything. You may think you do, I may think I do, but we don't. Humans, in fact, we only see a very small part of the space around us with our eyes. And there's something called saccade motion where your eyes actually jump. And you're populating a model in your visual cortex of the world around you. You don't actually monitor a light if you're stopped at the lights while it's red. Continuously, you notice changes in the model. And if you actually stare in a fixed way, you can get quite mesmerized. You can get quite hypnotized. You will actually find yourself getting tunnel vision and things closing in. So it's not about a human form of doing this. Most creatures don't do this, in fact. What do we really want to do? Well, I put this as a joke here. What we want perfect security, but actually we don't. Because with an adaptive opponent, if we ever had something called perfect security, humans would find a way to break it. They would move the battlefield up or down the stack, find a way around it, over it, through it. That's how we behave. So in fact, our goal, what we want I want to morph continuous monitoring into catching things more completely, sooner, more reliably, and eventually, if we can get them closer to the point of infection, we can get predictive. That's what I'd like. I want continuous monitoring to be more this. I want to be able to find the discontinuity sooner. I want to be able to find the breakout behavior, the threatening action, the invader in a network sooner. And I want to reverse the hacker advantage. And I think you do too. The way that we're going to get there and be future-proof is by pursuing improving our own game and doing this, regardless of what the bad guys do, regardless of what the attackers do. Our job isn't just to stop the latest attack and to prepare for the last war. And it's not just to do compliance. Those are part of it. What we've got to do is aim much higher. We have to fight, in other words, the ideal opponent, not just the one that's in front of us. And we have to be good at reversing this hacker advantage. We have to put the control and the initiative and the leverage of the asymmetry of cyber conflict in the hands of the defender. So this brings us to XDR. So there's a great formal definition for this I'd highly recommend. Forrester's Ali Mellon put a good one out there, but there are others out there that are really worth taking a look at in the analyst community. So let's talk a bit about SIM. SIM was about getting all the securities. Everything's security. It was Locard's principle writ large. First of all, XDR is not just the next iteration of SIM. SIM tries to do too much. It is very important that it covers a lot of the use cases it does, things like compliance and hygiene in the network and long-term reporting and even keeping all of the repository of everything that's happened when you aren't in a crunch to stop a bad person or bad attacker right now. This is why EDR in fact exists as a solution, endpoint detection response, and to some extent, network-based NTA or NBAD, pick your acronym of choice. But I'm gonna say that they exist because those cyber use cases were not done well enough by SIM. So for all that EDR looks like an extension of endpoint technologies, it's not really endpoint protection 2.0. It's not really that. It is in fact about a new way of catching hackers, and XDR is the next iteration of that. So obviously the X stands for extensible, or fill in the blank as I first used it nearly 5 years ago. The X in XDR says, I'm going to get telemetry regardless of the source that has an extremely high relevance to building the models and doing the analytics and being actionable post facto. So what I want to do is to find the hacker when they break away from the normal behaviors in the network. Whatever their techniques are, I need to get to a new plane and a new type of telemetry. So highly relevant input, not just from the endpoint as EDR did very effectively, but from all the other places too, the network, the cloud, identity, workloads, and all the new technologies coming, IoT, OT, even from new forms of infrastructure like 5G, as we'll look at in a minute. And you want to analyze it for the human, and you want to provide actionability. It's not just finding the signal sooner, it's finding the way that you can process it better and more reliably. So get the noise out, so get the false positives down, get the true positives up, and make sure that these things can lead to communication and to taking action. And the best use cases for XDR are detection, hunting, and remediation. SIM has not stretched to these well enough. XDR is in fact more likely to go backwards and get those other use cases later. But right now, the reason for XDR is this hyper-focus on finding the adaptive opponent, because we cannot wait for endpoint protection to do it and we can't wait for SIM to do it. So I did want to mention 5G because I know the emphasis here. 5G, I think of many different axes of technological advancement. And you could think, what's happening with endpoints? What's happening with cloud? But what's happening with 5G is, what is the connective tissue potentially in the connected world? And really the surface area of this n-dimensional object, or the equivalent, is expanding at a much greater rate. And what 5G is doing is it's leaping ahead and it's changing a lot of the realities. It does some great stuff. It increases edge compute, the number of systems that can work, the peer-to-peer capabilities, but it's also locally hackable. That edge compute is locally usable. Local DDoS becomes possible. We're talking about things like being able to do haptic feedback to a level where a remote surgeon could operate on a person, because the latency would get down to enough that it would be as if the person mentally was present. But what happens if the DDoS in that situation? What happens if the DDoS is even locally created? How do you resolve it? How do you find it when you have millions of systems connected locally and at the edge? So the more we hang off of it, the more critical it will become, the more uses we find, the more vulnerable those uses become. And it's this notion of combination with other advances in technologies like cloud, mobile, and IoT that are going to increase the surface of possibility, but also the surface of attack. So I think future-proofing, especially in a world of 5G and its peers, is about being able to do our thing in security across as many future environments. I think when it was first used, 6G was ridiculed, but there will be a next thing, just as there will be a next level of endpoint, and there will be a next level of cloud-based services. And what we have to be able to do is make sure that the abstraction that is our organizations and enterprises, as I've described it, is protectable, that we can have acceptable risk for acceptable return, regardless of what we slot under it, and how much that might uplift the potential for the connected world and for the bad guys and what they do. So here's what being future-proof is about. And I'm going to mention behavioral telemetry. I'm a big believer in behavioral telemetry and indicators of behavior. This is not the same thing as collecting anomalies or even finding them. So you will often hear behavior in the context of anomaly detection and instrumentation. That's not what I'm talking about. It's a subset. What we want to do here is acknowledge that low-card wasn't the right model for that, and that most security logs are a distraction for these use cases. I care for compliance reasons about six-failed logins. I don't care about that anymore, about finding the bad guy, because the bad guys don't get the password wrong. They don't do that in the 1990s way anymore. They get the password right, which means I need to know that a successful login has occurred, what happened before it, and what happened after it. Now, noise to signal is the biggest problem and weighs us down in a low-card enabled world, in a SIM world. So what we've got to do is find a different set of telemetry. Now, my belief is that this is behavioral telemetry. All the behaviors, good and bad, as an abstraction for what's really happening, that a process injects to a process, that a process spawns a process, a registry entry is touched, a file is touched, a communication happens over a network. And the reason that I think this is important is that activity should draw our attention. Eventually, bad people do bad things and they break away from the good. And so chains of behavior matter. I'm not interested just in catching a piece of malware at time X. I care, how did it get there? What else did the user do? What else happened on that machine? And so if we can abstract that as a language, then we can begin to do things like first and second order Boolean searches, and we can start to share queries and say, here's the behavior that typifies this actor or this attack or this campaign. And then we can share that. And currently, I'm working in a vendor-neutral way, even with some competitors, on describing a new indicator of behavior standard for exactly that reason with OASIS. And I invite you all to follow it online and to look at it. And I'm going to just say that even though I'm a big believer in this, this is the kind of innovation we have to do. We're not going to catch the supply chain hacks. We're not going to catch the ransomware attacks. We're not going to catch whatever the next thing is simply by doing more of what we've done and doubling the amount of certifications that we do, as if somehow there was an error in hygiene that led to the latest innovation by a bad guy breaking in. No, they are using our systems against us. In some cases, they know that we reimage systems when ransomware hits. So every time they potentially would leave some traces around for low-card to find, they detonate ransomware and the IT department cleans it up. They are, in other words, attacking us intelligently, as I said, an intelligent version of COVID-19 would do with body temperature for its host. So this is really a call to innovate. I'm a big believer in behavioral telemetry. I invite you all to join me for it. But in the end, it's about taking this attitude and getting better ourselves. So as a conclusion, what's the recipe for future-proof security, as I promised at the outset? Well, it's all about the approach. I believe it's about getting behavior from everywhere in an X sense, as in XDR. I think the principles of XDR, even if XDR becomes a SKU in a market, the principle will persist that we need to be able to build systems that find the anomaly sooner, more completely, and more actionably, even if the acronym changes. So follow for that. I don't think there's any silver bullets in our industry, but that's the thing we're pursuing, a better form of nervous system, a better form of analysis, a better form of autonomous system for correction and for fixing. Vigilance is about watching and monitoring ourselves. It's not just about watching and monitoring networks and continuously monitoring those, but doing the same and being introspective about ourselves. So be ever improving. Incremental improvement is much more important than gigantic leaps, which I love, like anyone. But in the words of Mark Twain, right, the perfect is the enemy of the good. That incremental incremental improvement is better than perfection. Perfection takes a long time to achieve, and in the meantime, we're failing. So small incremental changes, and avoid absolutism. I often attend conferences and someone says, I found a new way to do something. And everybody cheers. And then someone stands up and says, I found a corner case where it breaks, and we all get dejected. Security is not like that. It's not an all or nothing. It is, in fact, a question of how much more expensive can you make it for attackers? How much less likely can you make it for them? And even tools that are not perfect can help with that. In other words, some security is better than no security, and making small improvements in security will improve over time, get faster at it. So be vigilant over yourself, and please realize that if we can innovate and find this, not only can we get future-proof, we can actually reverse the hacker advantage. So thank you very much, and I look forward to hearing and working with you in the future.